This conference will now be recorded.
1 week FDP online FDP program on research challenges in power systems, which is our chips. Today we have eminent speaker with us who will be delivering his lecture on protection of smart grid systems. And the resource person name is Dr. D. Venugopal Garu. I would like to read out his profile. Dr. D. Venugopal Garu was born in Warangal district, Telangana state on 20th of June 1939. He completed BTech triply in 2001 and MTech in 2005 with specialization in ITPE from JNTU Hyderabad. He has completed PhD in fact specialization from JNTU Hyderabad in 2019. Presently, he is working as an associate professor in Electrical and Electronics Engineering Department, KITS, Singapore, Hyderabad, Karimnagar District, and Telangana. He has 19 years of teaching experience. He has published 9 journals and has presented 13 papers in national and international conferences. His research interests are power systems, distribution automation, facts, and smart grids. Thank you for giving me the chance to read out the profile of Dr. D. Venugopal Garu. Dr. D. Venugopal Garu, thank you, sir. Please take over the session, sir. I'm making you the presenter. Thank you.
Sir, good morning, sir. Sir, good morning.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Sir, I am about to share my presentation, sir.
Sir, you have to click on the screen button which is available at the bottom of your screen, sir, like mic, camera, screen.
Okay, sir.
You have to click on the screen, sir, then it will be sharing.
Okay, sir. Wait.
Srinivas, sir, please mute, sir. Hello.
Center.
Yes. Good morning.
Wait, sir. I'm sharing my screen.
MBA branch. Just 10 minutes.
Okay. My presentation.
Sir, did you get it?
Sir, I am seeing, sir. I'm just wait, sir.
Yeah, sure. Okay, sir. Okay.
That million I'm so tired. Million I'm so tired. Thank you.
Go to meeting mode. Yeah, share screen.
Hello sir, I am not getting the option, sir. Hello sir. Hello sir.
Sir, the green color button.
Hello sir, I am Venugopal speaking.
Yes sir.
Green color button, I have pressed the green color button, sir, beside that audio.
Yes sir, yes sir.
I have pressed that.
Open sir.
Yes sir, it is open sir. But it is not opening.
Okay. Sir, it is showing Srinivas sir screen.
It is showing Srinivas Rao sir screen, eh?
Yes sir, no sir. Okay, fine sir. You just click on this green color button which is of monitor sir.
Sir, yes, I have pressed it, sir. I have opened. I have touched that only, sir. I am unable to join the presenter.
Okay, sir. One second, sir. I'll check, sir. Just a second, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Hello, sir.
Sir, chapandi, sir.
Hello, sir. Good morning, Venugopal sir. We are able to see your screen, sir. Just open PPT, sir, now. Just open the PPT, sir. We are able to see your screen. It is very clear, sir. Yeah, it is clear, sir. Now it is visible, sir, your PPT. Again, gone back.
Visible, sir. My PPT is visible now.
Again, you gone back, sir.
Okay, sir. Wait, sir. Wait. It is not visible in the screen. That is the problem. Sir, is it visible, sir, now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, good morning to all. I am Dr. Venugopal, working as associate professor in Triple Department at KITS Singapore. A very warm welcome and I am here to present the presentation on smart grid protection. So smart grid protection is basically related to the main motivation for this smart grid protection is basically related to the reduced global warming, and it is mainly because of the insertion of the renewable energy sources, particularly wind energy, solar energy. So in our country, the government of India is targeted to install 100 gigawatt of solar and 60 gigawatt of wind by the year 2022. And here the definition for the microgrid is like this. It is a small scale power supply network that is designed to provide power for a small community. And the main objective of the microgrid is it enables local power generation for local loads. And it is comprising of various small power generating sources that makes it highly flexible and efficient. And here, coming to the advantages of the microgrid are, it is connected. It is mainly connected. It is mainly connected about the local generating units and the utility grid Local generating units refers to the distributed energy resources and thus preventing the power outages, because we can have the energy generation by making use of the distributed energy resources. So excess power which is being generated with the help of the distributed energy resources can be sold to the utility grid. And here coming to the say, because of the blackout condition, and as we are aware that in July 2012, due to the protection failure at the northern grid, there was a blackout. As we know that a blackout is a total crash of the power grid due to an imbalance between the power generation and the power consumption. So therefore, a selective power cut is a controlled shutdown of the selective power cut is a controlled shutdown of the power supply in a given area so as to avoid the blackouts. So our target of the government of India is to install 100 gigawatts of solar and 60 gigawatts of wind energy by 2022. This is the main motivation for the power system protection which is by making use of the smart grid system. So now I am concentrating about the, particularly I am concentrating about the from the literature surveys and literature, I'm concentrating about the microgrid. Just before we have defined the microgrid, this is a single line diagram of the microgrid. The grid is comprising of the utility load and the relays ranging from R1 to R6. Those are the different the relays. And here we have the total. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 buses. And here we have the two different types of the distributed energy resources, namely synchronous based distributed energy resources and inverter based distributed energy resources, where SBDER is referred by synchronous based distributed energy resources, and IBDER refers to the inverter based distributed energy resources. And here the microgrid is comprising of these components, namely distributed generation and loads. Names here, the loads are named as in the single line diagram as UL. UL refers to as utility loads. And next, immediate storage. So we have the battery energy storage systems. So storage energy facilities also required in case of the distributed energy resources. Then we have the controllers. Controllers are mainly meant for the microgrid control center. Then the point of common coupling. So point of common coupling, these are all the microgrid components which we have in case of the the microgrid, which we can call them as the microgrid components. So microgrid components, the size of the microgrid can be ranging from a housing estate to the municipal regions. That means we can have this microgrid, we can install a microgrid with reference to a single house or a single apartment, and also if we have the facility of the distributed energy resources where the availability of wind is more, where the availability of the solar energy is good for the power generation to take place, in such case we can extend it for municipal regions also. And the power which we have, surplus power, can be sold to the utility grid. That is one of the advantage which we have in case of the microgrid, right? And coming to the next thing is related to the microgrid operating modes. So microgrid can be operated in two different modes, namely grid connected mode and islanded mode. So this is the grid connected mode. In the grid connect, the diagram depicts the grid connected mode. In the grid connected mode, we have the utility grid is active. That means we cannot have the sufficient generation from the distributed energy resources. So therefore we have to receive the power, we have to get the power from the utility grid. Utility grid in our country is Power Grid Corporation of India. And under that, we have the different regional loads, regional grids. We have the southern grid, northern grid, northeastern grid, like that. So we have to receive the power from the utility grid. So here in the grid connected mode, we have the utility grid is in the active mode. That means we are receiving the power from the utility grid, and the static switch is closed. So we are going to make use of the several power electronic converters for the operations to take place in a reliable manner. So that's why the static switch is to be closed, and all the feeders are being supplied by the utility grid. That means there is no feeder is being connected with the distributed energy resources. That is one of the thing which we have in case of the operation of the grid connected mode. So that's why if you see the slide number 4, in which currently we are discussing the protection issues in smart grid. In this, the protection system must respond to both utility grid and the microgrid pulse. So microgrid pulse are protection isolates the smallest possible section of the radial feeder to eliminate the fault. So here you see we have the internal faults, we have the external faults. So if you see the diagram in which we can have the microcontrollers and the circuit breakers and the priority loads. Priority loads means hospital loads and the secretariat and the various emergency sectors where in which we have to give the top priority. So for them we can call them as the priority loads. The feeders are emanating for the priority loads, and we have the non-priority loads. Non-priority load means we can take small scale which may have some revenue which is as mentioned by the government which is not mainly meant for the industrial loads. They may be, we can call them as the non-priority loads. And as we discussed just before, that point of common coupling which is very important, which is one of the the microgrid component in case of the microgrid which we are currently discussing, and the static switches. So and the static switch is closed, as we have mentioned just before that, in grid connected mode. And then the dotted lines, the red dotted lines represents the protection system, and the sectional circuit breaker which is being represented by the symbol in the slide, and the central controller is represented by CC. So this is the diagram which is we can use the various protection schemes for the protection of the system against the internal faults. Internal faults may be the failure of the power electronic converters, failure of the controller, failure of the recloser, failure of the bus bar section, failure of the connectors, also failure of the connecting switches or isolating switches. So they are refers to the internal faults. The external faults, as we are aware, that external faults are mainly because of the the symmetrical faults and the unsymmetrical faults which we have in case of the smart grid distribution system. So which is mainly which currently we are interested for. Okay, and then we have the another mode of operation which is islanded mode of operation. So islanded mode of operation is mainly in which the utility grid is not supplying power. That means we are not receiving the power from the utility grid, like as we have discussed just before in the slide, when which we are receiving the power from Power Grid Corporation of India in the grid connected mode where utility grid is active. But that is not possible. That is not we are going to perform with respect to the islanded mode. In the utility grid is not supplying power, which is one of the thing in case of the islanded mode. And the static switch is open, which was closed in the earlier case. But as it is the islanded mode of operation, the static switch is to be closed, and the feeders are being supplied from the micro sources. So because we are discussing with reference to the microgrid, the single line diagram pertaining to the microgrid where several distributed energy resources are there. The distributed energy resources we have several distributed resources, as we have the distributed resources are we have some 7 to 8 distributed resources. Like one thing is photovoltaic distributed energy resource, and the micro turbine distributed resource, and windmill, typical windmill, and battery energy storage system and generator, fuel cell, and even the municipal solid waste, say the power plants, which is mainly initiated by the municipal department. So far, these are all several things which we have under the distributed energy resources, right? And so here, as we have discussed that in the microgrid operation, we have, as we have discussed just before that in the microgrid operation, we have the advanced power electronic interface modules. So the the interfacing modules are very, very important, just as we have discussed that point of common coupling and the other things like loads, immediate storage and controllers and the distributed energy resources just we have discussed. So the interconnection of these things are very, very important. The advanced power electronic interface modules, the module functions are refers to the power conversion and the inverter and the power conditioning and the protection and the output interface and the distributed energy resources, local load and ancillary services and monitoring and control. So these are all the several things. And under the storage device, we have the electromechanical energy storage, battery energy storage, super capacitors, thermal storage, and the kinetic energy inertia storage, superconducting magnetic energy storage. These are all the several forms of storage of the energy resources. So the module functions are mainly covering about the power conversion, the power conversion issues, in which we have the operation of the rectification and inverter action, and then power conditioning with respect to the voltage, with respect to the reactive balance, reactive power balance, and with respect to the voltage limits, like with the, which is as being prescribed by Indian Electricity Code plus or minus 6%, right? And also the protection aspect, that means operation of the primary relay and the secondary relay and all those things. So we have to take care of all these things as a part of the modular protection or the modular functionalities, right? And here under this, we have the protection issues in case of this smart grid, in the utility grid falls. The utility grid falls, the protection isolates the microgrid from the utility grid as rapidly as necessary to protect the microgrid loads. That means the microgrid is, it can be operated by dependent on the utility grid, or else if the utility, even you can stop the supply from the utility grid and utilize the generation that is being generated by the distributed energy resources. Okay, and then coming to the next, we are going for the microgrid, need of the microgrid, right? So this is the microgrid protection. So in the microgrid protection, this diagram represents the flow of the fault currents through the relays in the distributed network. For the symbols represents to the fault point F and the dynamics in the level of fault currents at the relay 5, fault stripping for relay 4 or relay 3, and blinding of protection with reference to the relays R1 and R6. There are 6 relays are there for the single end diagram of the microgrid relay, just which we have seen in the earlier things, right? So then I'm discussing about the need of the microgrid. The microgrid could be the answer to our energy crisis. We can say that it is an answer to the energy crisis. The transmission losses are highly reduced because of the introduction of the microgrid. That is one of the, important point which we can have with the help of this microgrid. The losses, the transmission losses and the distribution, even the distribution losses are also drastically minimized because we are utilizing the local generation to the local loads. So that is the main objective in case of the microgrid. That's why the losses, the transmission and the distribution losses are highly reduced by the insertion of the microgrid, right? And then other coming to the other need of hour for the discussion of the microgrid, coming to the need of microgrid results in the substantial savings and cuts the emission without major changes to the lifestyles. That is, that means we can have say we can reduce our electricity bill, because we can generate the electricity on the top of our building or top of our apartment, and we can utilize to our house application or our domestic loads. Thereby we can reduce our electricity bill. And then also this the size of the microgrid range practically range practical size of the microgrid is limited to a few megavolt amperes MVA. The size of the microgrid is measured in MVAs. And also we can say that microgrid encourages the use of the renewable energy sources, large scale and the use of say large land use of impacts, like as we have in conventional energy sources, in particularly in thermal energy generating stations, and we have the hydroelectric power generating stations, and we have other conventional energy sources like nuclear power generating stations, where large land use impacts are there, and also CO2 emissions because of burning of coal, because of say usage of the several nuclear materials, and all those things which will definitely introduce the lot of emissions, carbon dioxide emissions, highly minimized by making use of this microgrid. So that's why microgrid, say we can say the need of power, there is a lot of scope for the microgrid usage as far as this this positive impacts are considered. And coming to the we may have a, let me discuss a point about the some of the differences, we have to discuss about the what is the difference between the microgrid and the conventional grid, right? So if you see the comparison wise of the conventional grid and the microgrid, the efficiency, the overall efficiency of the conventional grid is less when compared with the overall efficiency of the microgrid. And also there is a large amount of energy is wasted in the form of heat, as we have just before we have discussed in case of the say thermal energy storage systems, and potential energy of water or high potential head is available, a large potential head is available in case of the hydroelectric power station. So therefore huge economic investment is required in case of the hydroelectric plants on the reservoirs and dams, etc. So that amount of large amount of energy is wasted, and also large amount of investment is also required, which is not there as in case of the microgrid. So therefore the main thing here is in power sources in microgrid are small and located in close proximity to the load. That's what we have discussed. That means under the top of the building we can have the distributed energy source like PV, photovoltaic energy systems, or we can have the windmill where the availability of wind speed is more than 4 meters per second, which is the cut-in velocity. So therefore we can say have the lot of say scope for the microgrid, which we may see in very near future, which is also one of the say comparative advantage with respect to the conventional grid. And coming to the other things like comparison wise, the other advantages like as we have in case of the microgrid, herein we have the microgrid. The major advantage of the microgrid is its ability during the the utility grid disturbance, like there is a failure or there is a loss of power or there is a shutdown of the unit or maintenance of the particular thermal power energy unit or something, that kind of the disturbances can be overcome by separating or by isolating itself from the utility and seamlessly with little or no disruption to the load. That means the power interruption to the supply to the customers can be largely minimized, and the loads within the microgrid are experienced no disturbances. There is no disruption of the power supply to the loads, or we can say that little disturbance even during the changeover from the utility grid to the normal grid. That is, that's also one of the advantage as we have in case of the microgrid. And coming to the peak load points, we have there is a chance of say curtailment of the power, which is one of the thing which we have in case of the these say microgrid things. In the peak load periods, it may prevent the utility grid failure by selecting or by reducing the load on the grid. So therefore, significant environmental benefits are made possible by the use of low or zero emission generators. That is also one of the say comparison thing which we have in case of the microgrid, right? And coming to the other comparative studies, the increasing the overall energy efficiency by the use of both electricity and heat permitted by the close proximity of the generator to the user. That is the main advantage of microgrid. And say we can say that, and finally we can say one point, microgrid can act to mitigate the energy cost to its users by generating some or all of its electricity needs. So that is the fundamental thing or the fundamental advantage which we have in case of the microgrid, right? So therefore, microgrid protection is one of the most important challenges facing the implementation of the microgrid. But when, because we are inserting our own domain distributed energy resources, and we are say receiving power from the utility grid, which is with a standard frequency of 50 Hz. So synchronization of the frequency which is being generated by the distributed energy resources with respect to the frequency which is being supplied by the utility grid. So that those protection things are also very, very important. And reactive power balance, reactive power generation is equal to reactive power consumption, where but the voltage control is to be maintained. So that that thing is also we have to see in case of this microgrid protection. These are all some of the say the tasks or the challenges which we have in case of microgrid protection, right? So that's why the microgrid protection, the issues such as standby changes and net metering may pose obstacles for microgrid, because when we are going for the microgrid, we have to fix the net metering. As we are aware that currently we are using the energy meters. Energy meters will give the usage of the energy by the consumers in kilowatt hours. Say today I am using 100 kWh. That means the usage of the electricity in the house or in the say in the apartment. It may be say ranging from few hundred to some 500 kilowatt hours or 1000 kilowatt hours if it is with respect to an apartment. So therefore, if we go for the microgrid, we have to install the particular energy storage systems or energy say generating units, and we have to know what is the magnitude of the power or magnitude of the energy that is deliberately generated by the energy resources which are being fixed on the top of the buildings or the adjacent to the building or the space availability near to the area or the facility or the municipality region where in which we are concentrating. So therefore, we have to see the standby changes and the net metering obstacles of the microgrid. That is, what is the net savings as a result of the introduction or as a result of the insertion of the distributed energy resources into the system. That is also very, very important. So therefore, in the microgrid thing, what we are microgrid protection, what we are doing here is the interconnection standards are need to be developed for the ensure consistency. Therefore, here we have the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers IEEE P1547, which is standard proposed by IEEE, may end up in filling the void. That means this is mainly the IEEE P1547, which is the standard which is being proposed by the Institute of Engineers, Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, which is mainly say concentrating about the issues like say connecting the distributed energy resources with the utility loads or with the utility, sorry, with the utility grid. What are the various things which we are going to see? That is the one of the thing which we are going to find, which we are going to see in, with respect to the interconnection things which we have in case of the say the interconnection of the protection of the particular microgrid to the thing. So therefore, if you see in the microgrid protection, with this knowledge, if you see in this microgrid protection, we have the utility grid, we have the utility grid on the left hand side, and we on the right hand side we have the synchronous based distributed energy resources. Synchronous based distributed energy resources, here I mean the wind energy, which is basically operating by means of the singly fed induction generator or doubly fed induction generator. So as we are making use of the SFIG or DFIG, therefore it has to operate with the synchronous speed. That's why they are operating as they are called. Therefore, we are naming them as the synchronous based distributed energy resources. And inverter based distributed energy resources means we are going to make use of the solar energy. So we in the solar energy, direct current which is being stored in the batteries can be converted into the alternating current by making use of the inverter technology. So henceforth, we are naming them as the inverter based distributed energy resources. And here we have in the microgrid protection in this slide, if you see, we have the microgrid protection slide. In this, if you see the sectionalizers, say like sectionalizer 1, sectionalizer 2, and we have the relays numbered from R1 to R6. Those are the six different types of the relays. And here the fault current with reference to the say occurrence of the fault, which is designated by the red colored dotted line at a particular faulted point where the cross symbol in the diagram refers to the faulted loop point, which is in between the relays R5 and R6, right? So here coming to here also we have one thing, the blinding of protection. So let me discuss about the blinding of protection. Blinding of protection means the protection of the blinding. This is we are going to make use of the overcurrent relays for the protection of this microgrid. We are going to make use of the there are different types of the relays, as we are aware that at present we are making use of the microprocessor based relays, and we can also name them as static relays, and so therefore the protection of the blinding in overcurrent relays leading to a delay or non-tripping of the relay, right? So the non-tripping of the relay means, suppose we have relay 6 is unable to clear the fault. Let us say in this diagram, relay 6 is unable to clear the fault. So then therefore the immediately the relay 5 has to sense that the particular occurrence of the fault and giving a tripping or alarm indication to the associated circuit breaker. Then it is to be the particular section is to be isolated from the healthy portion of the particular microgrid for which we are operating, right? So therefore we can say that the protection of the blinding in overcurrent relays leads to a delay or non-tripping of the relay. Whenever there is a delay or whenever the relay is non-tripping, in such case we are going for say the blinding of operation, right? And therefore the conventional solution for the blinding issue is to increase the sensitivity in the relay settings. The variations of the relay settings may cause problems in the distributed network, and therefore the operation of the directional relays or the overcurrent relays and the reclosers is dependent on the detection of the abnormal current. Abnormal current means if I am fixing the plug setting multiplier, which is the ratio of the current flows through the section as the ratio of the reference current which is being fixed, So in that case, what we are doing here is we are going to see, we are going to find there is an abnormal deviation or abnormal flow of the current in a particular sectionalizer. So that that is maybe the insertion of the various factors or various the setting of the loads and all other things. So therefore, all the protective systems that are based on the protection devices suffer from the malfunctioning because of the reduced contribution of the grid, right? So therefore, this mechanism belongs to the first category of the protection problems and is known as the blinding of protection, right? That means we have to know what is the relay, what kind of the relay is to be used, what is the primary relay, what is the backup relay. So these things are to be properly these are to be properly identified, and accordingly we have to see the protection aspect of the particular relay, right? And coming to the protection issues in case of the microgrid, or we can say that it is a smart grid, because we can have a synonymous name as for the microgrid as smart grid, because we are using the smart meters, smart technology, and we are using the generating resources which are close to the utility load. So therefore, we can also have the name as smart grid also, right? So protection issues in smart grid are like there are four different categories under the protection issues in smart grid. They are like dynamics in levels of fault currents, and bidirectional fault current, and false tripping, and blinding of protection. So just before, I have discussed about the blinding of protection, and here in this, the dynamics of in levels of fault currents refers to the intensity of the magnitude of the fault current. So sometimes the magnitude of the fault current, as we are aware that power system network must be self resilient. That means for the minor and incipient faults, the system has to recover, or system has to heal, self healing. That is also one of the property of the power system network. So it has to self heal with reference to the small incipient or minor faults. If the magnitude of the fault current or the magnitude of the fault level is very high, in such case only it will hamper, or it will harm the power system network in very sarcastic way. That's why, so therefore we have to ensure that about the level of the magnitude of the fault current. That is also one of the important thing which we have in case of the dynamics in levels of the fault currents. And the bidirectional fault currents means sometimes depending upon the location of the relays, depending upon the location of the feeders, we have the bidirectional fault currents. And also because of the failure of the relays, or because of the the malfunctioning of the relays, we may have instead of relay 4, relay 6 may operate. Instead of relay 6, relay 5 may operate. So that kind of the thing we may use to call, we may refer to as the fault tripping, right? So therefore, the proper mechanism is to be identified for the protection issues which we have referred in case of the blinding of protection. Okay, and then coming to the dynamics in levels of fault currents, we will see it one by one what is all those things. So dynamics in levels of the fault currents are mainly because of the penetration of the distributed energy resources alters the level of the fault current, and also the magnitude of the fault current is altered based on the modes of operation of the microgrid. Just as we have discussed that there are two different types of modes of operation, namely grid connected mode of operation and islanded mode of operation. So these two things are very common and very synonymous things in case of the operation of the microgrid. They are named under the thing like the static switch is being closed, static switching being opened, like point of common coupling, right? So, and the loads and the generating sources one, generating sources two, and the low voltage which is being connected, LV bus, right? And the load, the utility load is represented by L, So this reduces the sensitivity of the protection systems. That means we may have the dynamics of the levels of the fault currents as we have. Say if you see in case of the during the grid connected mode, what we have the magnitude of the fault current. Let us consider there is a fault has been taken up on the particular feeder which is being connected from LV to generator 2. If you see in this slide, the magnitude of the fault current, which is being represented by the magnitude of the fault generator fault current plus magnitude of the DER G1F plus magnitude of the G2F. So these are all three currents put together, we have the total magnitude of the current. And coming to the magnitude of the fault current in case of the grid islanded mode. Islanded mode means we don't have the supply from the main grid, right? That means point of common coupling where the static switch is being open. There is no connection between main grid to the particular microgrid. That's why the fault, the level of the magnitude of the fault current is equals to IG1F plus IG2F, right? So that is the difference which is with respect to the grid connected mode of operation and the islanded mode of operation. Okay, and coming to the bidirectional flow, the bidirectional fault current, right? So here in this bidirectional fault current, the penetration of the direct energy resources is not only changes the level of the fault current but also alters the direction. That means we see there is a difference magnitude of the flow of the direction of the current, that is with reference to IG1, IGF1, IGF2. If you see the red dotted line, green dotted line, and the magnitude of the current is going to be altered, the bidirectional fault current in case of the microgrid for the same say diagram which we have seen in the earlier things for the dynamics levels of the fault current. So therefore here the traditional unidirectional overcurrent relays are unable to provide safety protection for the microgrids. Okay, and this is the next thing. And coming to the false tripping, it includes this issues is mainly arises in the distributed energy resources. Here you see we have the two relays R1 and R2 on the LV stream, on the LV bus, for the two feeders which are being connected, feeder 1 and feeder 2. For the feeder 1, we have the generator 1 and the utility load L and point of common coupling and circuit breaker with a static switch being opened or closed depending upon the mode of operation. And the main grid is being connected with the microgrid. So the fault stripping of the microgrid conforming here is when we have the fault current contribution from generator 1 exceeds the current setting, then the relay 1 will be tripped before the operation of the faulted feeder relay 2. As a result, the unnecessary power interruption will occur for the loads connected to the LT feeder. This is with respect to the false tripping. And blinding of protection, as we have discussed just before that, the blinding of protection, we have the utility grid contribution to the fault current is reduced due to the contribution from the distributed generation sources. As a result, the feeder relay is unable to detect the fault condition. Okay, this phenomenon is known as the blinding of protection and is being demonstrated with the help of this figure. In the blinding of protection, you see utility grid contribution to the fault current is reduced because of the insertion of the distributor's resource, say generator 1 DG. Here G1 is there in case of this particular distributor generator in this figure. And this with the feeder relay is unable to detect the fault condition. Am I audible? Yes, anybody?
Sir.
Am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Audible, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, sir.
Okay, okay. Right, thank you. We are going, now we are going to discuss about the protection issues. To discuss the protection briefly for a 4-bus distribution network, which is being shown in the figure. In this figure, we have the 4 buses, namely the buses are at relay 1 and relay 2 and at S2, that is with reference to this externalizer at SB, synchronous based distributed energy resource, and the inverter based distributed energy resource, that is at S3. And here, to discuss about this 4-bus distributed network, which is based on the synchronous based and the inverter based, having the switches from S1 to the switches are from S1 to S3, and the relays are from R1 to R6 are considered here, and the magnitude of the fault current at this due to the synchronous based distributed energy relay is being calculated at the switch S2 is is represented by IFR6 is equals to 5 times of the magnitude of the current which is being generated by the synchronous based distributed energy resource. And the fault is being initiated or the fault is being occurred in between the relays R5 to R6, and the magnitude of the fault current is calculated by the inverter based, the current which is being inverter is being driven from the inverter based distributed energy resource, and the current from the other direction, which is from the main grid, that is being considered. And for the flow of the fault current through the relays in the distributed networks is depending on the dynamics in the level of the fault currents due to at the relay 5 and the false tripping of relay 4 or relay 3, and blinding of protection with reference to the relays R1 comma R6. So that means either R1 or R6. So this is about the thing which we have. So therefore, here we have, this is the proposed adaptive protection schemes. From the literature, I have taken these adaptive protection schemes, which are mainly used for the microgrid environment scheme for the same 4-bus which we have discussed. But here in the earlier diagram, we have not included the microgrid control center, but here we have included the microgrid control center, which is plays very important role as far as the operation of the microgrid and the energy utilization or the energy mobilization from the distributed energy resources to the utility loads. UL stands for the utility loads which are connected with reference to the microgrid for which we are mainly operating. So therefore, the mode of operation, the schematic diagram of the microgrid with the control center, that is the main idea here. The microgrid control center plays an important role as far as the operation of the particular microgrid is considered, right? So therefore, we have to know some of the nomenclatures, or we have to see some of the things, like here we have to know some definitions related to the operation of the overcurrent relays, because we are making use of the directional overcurrent relays, which we are shortly we are naming them as the DOCR. DOCR stands for the directional overcurrent relays. So in the directional overcurrent relays, an additional feature of the time multiplier setting. Time multiplier setting is provided. Time multiplier setting or time dial setting, both are same. The basic idea is that by increasing or decreasing the time multiplier setting, the relay operating time can be increased or decreased. Suppose you want to curtail the fault within very small magnitude of time of the order of microseconds or milliseconds or nanoseconds. So in that case, you can initiate the fault, you can decrease the time multiplier setting, or you can decrease the time dial setting and accordingly you can initiate the operation of the relay. And suppose if you want to increase the time of operation to from instead of nanoseconds to some milliseconds or microseconds, so you can decrement it from say nanoseconds to microseconds. That means the order of changing of the operation of the relay is basically depending on the time of time multiplier setting, or in short, or in other words, it can be named as a time dial setting, and it can be defined as the for the given plug setting multiplier. Plug setting multiplier in case of the relays can be defined as the standard current as the ratio of the reference current. So standard current may be some 5 amperes, reference current may be some 6 amperes. So let us have an example as a glance. So we have to take the ratio of these two things for the given plug setting multiplier. We have to fix the time. The times are like T, capital T refers to the desired relay operating time, and T, capital T suffix small m refers to the corresponding operating time at a time multiplier setting of 1.0. So therefore, the time setting multiplier is defined as the ratio of capital T to the capital T with a suffix of small m, right? So which is we usually call it as the say the time setting multiplier. So time setting multiplier, as we have just before discussed, that it is also referred to as the time dial setting, right? And here also we have to define another two terms, namely there are two different types of the relays. We have the primary relays and the backup relay. Both the things are say required, because protection device coordination is very, very important. So for the each relay, as we know that for each relay there is an associate circuit breaker. Say suppose we have the primary relay, we have an associated circuit breaker. Say primary relay having a SF6 circuit breaker is having, say it is operating with respect, if the primary relay is giving a tripping signal on alarm indication, then the particular SF6 relay will isolate, or the say it will open the particular faulted portion of the network. Similarly, if the primary relay is unable to clear the fault, the primary relay fails to say the trip the particular fault, then the backup relay, that means PR refers to the primary relay, B capital R refers to the backup relay. So in the event of failure of the primary relay, backup relay is being comes into the action. So therefore we have to define them as the regulated device to operate at first is called as the main protection, which is probable to fault and it operates quickly, right? That is one of the say point which we have in case of the what we can say primary relay, right? And the other device operates as a backup protection, and it is operates when the main protective device does not operate. That means when the main protective device is fails to operate the particular fault which is being initialized, which is being initiated on the feeder, then that we usually call it as a backup relay, right? So based on this, why we are discussing here primary relay and backup relay is we have to know the coordination time interval. As I am discussed just before that, in the protection aspect, for the protection of a particular feeder, say suppose we are feeding power to a very important metro station or very important metro line where the passengers are to be say they are moved from one particular station to another station, and also in a very thick hospital line, there the importance of the protection or the importance of the operation of the relays is very, very important, very, very plays very, very important role. So therefore coordination time interval, CTI between the primary relay and the secondary relay is very, very important with respect to the microgrid protection. And fourth, coordination time interval is the time interval between the main and backup relays. why I am discussing the usage of the power system protection, coordination of the protection devices like relays and the circuit breakers is, so the relays and circuit breakers are properly to be operated, or if the primary relay is unable to clear the fault, if the primary relay is say not in a position to isolate the fault, in such case we have to make use of the secondary relay, or the backup relay is to be used. And the coordination time interval is very, very important for the operation of the relays. So therefore CTI stands for, now we are going for the in the next coming discussions we are going for the CTI is refers to the coordination time interval between the main and the backup relays, right? So that is the main objective here for the thing. And as we know that in this already we have discussed this diagram, grid connected mode of operation and transition to islanded reconnection modes of operation. That means we have to connect the system whenever the islanded whenever the there is a no supply, there is no supply is being given from the grid, utility grid, which we have considered here. Then in such case we are moving from transition. You see the cyclic diagram which is referred by the arrow mark symbols represents the operation of the grid connected mode, then transition to next stage, transition to the islanded mode of operation, right? And here we are using the proposed adaptive protection schemes for the microgrid environment. So here you see the mode of operation is making use of the overcurrent relays. So if you see the first phasor diagram in which overcurrent relay is being written, there is an in phase, that means the primary current and the fault current, they are in line in case of the overcurrent relay. In case of the directional relay, if you see there is a deviation, there is an angle of say difference between the fault current IF1 and the primary voltage VP, and also there is a difference of angle between the VP and IF2, right? So which is in case of the microgrid control center with reference to the thing. So therefore here we are going for from the literature, we are going for the, there are two different types of the schemes which I am going to discuss in this presentation. One is the conventional protection coordination approach, and other one is the adaptive protection coordination approach. Both are being utilized, both are being used here as far as the say the discussions related to the protections, microgrid protection scheme which we are currently considered, right? So here if you see the steps which are to be followed, which have been represented in this slide as like this, the maximum positive sequence current. So as we know that the magnitude of the current can be summed up as say the positive sequence current, negative sequence current and zero sequence current. So there is a matrix 1 lambda square, lambda square, 1 lambda, lambda square, we have to make use of the transformation, right, for the breakup of the positive sequence current and negative sequence currents, right? So here the maximum positive sequence pre-fault current is being considered for the conventional protection coordination approach, right? And it is from the next step, the maximum positive sequence fault current is to be identified, and it is to be initiated by the each relay. That is also to be considered here as far as this conventional protection approach, right? And next one is, as we have discussed just before, that time dial setting. Time dial setting is the ratio of time of operation to the corresponding operating time of the particular TMS, right? Time multiplier setting or time dial setting, right? So here lowest time dial setting is very, very important because we have to eliminate, we have to remove the unhealthy part of the power system network or the distributed network which we are considering here. So therefore we have to eliminate it as early as possible. So henceforth we can say that the lowest time delay setting needs to be considered And the coordination time interval, just before I am discussing that, coordination time interval is the interval, time interval between the main and the backup relay, right? So it's, which is also very, very important for the protection of this smart grid network, right? Then we have the positive sequence fault current seen by the backup relay and the time dial setting, right? And also for the backup relay is also to be seen, right? So here we have the mathematical equations, which is reference to the time multiplier setting, time dial setting for the proposed sequence current based adaptive protection approach, right? So these are the some of the equations which are being used for calculation of the fault current for the primary relay and backup relay. As we have discussed that the time interval is to be calculated, that means the time interval which is with reference to the coordination, that means whether the first relay, primary relay is operating or whether the backup relay is operating, if what is the time interval or the gap between the primary relay and the secondary relay. So those things are to be seen. So henceforth, that's for the calculation purpose. We have seen, if you see the equations, we have the TP refers to the time of operation of the primary relay. TB refers to the time of operation of the backup relay, right? And TMS refers to the what we can say, time multiplier setting, right? Time dial setting. And the time multiplier setting equation is being referred with respect to the operation of those things. Then we have the fault estimation using the superimposed currents. So here we are making use of the Kirchhoff's voltage law and fault direction estimation using the superimposed currents, that is reverse and forward faults and the pre-fault power flow at the relay for the at the bus G, right? And so say we have E, G, H, those are the three buses, and fault initiated at in between E and G, in between G and H, and grid, the switch, that is the sectionalizer static switch, which is either being opened or closed. Here you see, if you see in the studied system, the switch is being opened, that means it is operating in the islanded mode, right? So for the islanded mode of operation, the positive sequence equivalent circuit for the pre-fault situation is being written, and based on this we are going to calculate the magnitude of the positive sequence pre-fault current at the relays in bus, at bus G. The voltage equations and the current equations, and both are being written, and the positive sequence pre-fault current at the relay which is corresponding to bus G, which is depending on the impedance of the distributed network. This is from the equations which we have seen in case of the positive sequence pre-fault current at the relay bus G. Then coming to the positive sequence fault current for the fault at F1, for the voltage equations are being written again, from this diagram, they are referring to as like this. And again, the positive sequence current for the at the fault F1 side. So we have F1 and F2. F1 is in between E and G, F2 is in between G and H, right? And you see, for the unbalanced loads in this particular positive sequence fault current, for the fault at F1 point is in between grid, the utility grid, and the switch, the static switch, which is being opened for the islanded mode of operation. Excuse me. Hello. Hello. This is for the fault current being initiated for the fault at F1 point. And therefore, here we have, say in this case, we have the magnitude of the fault current for the relay location during the fault at F1 side. Similarly, the fault positive sequence fault current at F2 side, for the same diagram, the positive sequence equivalent circuit for a fault at the F2 side is also being considered. And the positive sequence fault currents for faults at F2 point and the voltage equations and all those things are being written here. And the phasor diagrams referring to the fault direction estimation using superimposed currents. And here we have, there are two different streams of flow of power. One is the downstream power flow condition and the upstream power flow condition. The diagram A referring to the phasor diagram A referring to the downstream power flow condition. Phasor diagram B referring to the upstream power flow condition. So here we have to consider the rule base as we are discussing about the conventional approach. So the rule base for the directional element is for the particular four bus system which we have considered, for the upstream is from left to right and downstream is from right to left as indicated in the slide. And here the power flow direction are say with reference to the, there are four rule, 2 square 2 to the power of 2, we have the fault point and the phase, the magnitude of the phase, and the decision is to be considered here. For the upstream power flow, for the forward fault point, there is a negative phase sequence and the decision is -1. For the upstream power flow direction, for the reverse fault point, the delta psi 1 or delta psi 2 is positive, so the decision is positive here for the directional element. As similar to the power flow directions upstream, for downstream also we have both forward and reverse, which we have the decisions are to be taken as +1 and -1. So this is the rule base for the directional element. So this is say for the description of the proposed protection approach. So as have mentioned in the beginning of the presentation that we are going to make use of the directional over current relay approach. So we are going to make use of the directional over current relays. So in the directional over current relay, we are going to have say this is the algorithm, or we can say this is the procedure is to be followed for the protection approach of the smart grid with the help of the directional over current relay. And start, this is the algorithm. Current samples are sampled at a sampling frequency of 1 kilohertz. So this is performed at the microgrid control center, and fault detection using cycle to cycle comparison technique. Then pre-fault and fault current phasor estimation using one cycle discrete Fourier transform. Then calculation of the positive sequence current and negative sequence current components for the pre-fault and fault currents. Then from that, the breakup is identification of the fault type and the faulted section, or computation of the superimposed positive sequence currents. And again under that, we have calculation of the adaptive time dial setting using storage primary current and time dial setting and the minimum fault current of the grid connected mode. Or else we can go for the computation of the angle between the superimposed and the pre-fault positive sequence currents. Then we can go for either trip time is computed using 1 or 2, provide a primary or backup protection operation, or applying rule base to determine the fault direction. Then the decision is to be taken whether the relay has to trip or non-tripping of the relay. Based on that, the particular circuit breaker will operate. If the relay trips, the circuit breaker will isolate the particular unhealthy portion of the network. That is depending upon the all the actions which are being inserted based on the sampling frequency, based on the discrete Fourier transform and all those things. So for the simulation results for the four bus distribution network are as follows like this. So just before I am mentioning that, results for the grid connected mode of operation. The results of the calculations of the fault currents, settings and the time of operation of the directional over current relays for the grid connected mode, right? So here if you see in this results, in this particular results table, if you see there are two different approaches, namely say adaptive approach and conventional approach. And we have the fault point, FP refers to the fault point, and PR refers to the primary relay, BR refers to the backup relay, and say the current of ICPBJ refers to the primary current, and then say the CTA refers to the coordination time interval, and then TDS refers to the time dial setting. And you see, so for the four bus system, we have in the earlier diagram, we have say F1, F2, F3 are created as like this, 3.5 kilometers, 4.25 kilometers, 2.2 kilometers are simulated. And they are tabulated as like this for the relays R1, R2, R4, R6 from ranging from relay 1 to relay 6 with reference to the faulted points F1, F2, F3 and the corresponding CTA time coordination time intervals are calculated in the adaptive approach and conventional approach, right? So if you see in the adaptive approach, the CTI for F1 is for 0.301. If you say refers to conventional approach, 0.319. That means adaptive approach is superior when compared to the conventional approach. In similar, for relay 6, we have 0.306 in case of adaptive approach. As in case of CTI, in case of the conventional approach, it is 0.360, right? So whatever the aspect you see, if the coordination time intervals are good with reference to the adaptive approach when compared with the conventional approach. You see the values 0.301, 0.306, 0.304, 0.305, 0.335, 0.299, which are superior values when compared with 0.319, 0.360, 0.354, 0.373, 0.393, 0.354. So therefore, you can say that adaptive approach is good with reference to the protection aspect is concerned, right? Similarly, the results of operation, right? Results of for the identity mode of operation, same for the same system, results of calculation of the fault current settings and the time of operation of the directional overcurrent relays for the islanded mode of operation. In similar, the encircled values, if you see 0.303, 0.302, and 0.450, 0.219, only with reference to R6, 0.219, which is a good value in conventional approach. Otherwise, 0.303 with reference to 0.450, which is superior in case of the faulted portion 1, right? So this is about the results for the islanded mode of operation. And then coming to the performance evaluation of the proposed directional currents, right? So these are some of the performance things. M1 refers to the microgrid, M2 refers to the islanded operation, and M3 refers to the disconnection of the distributed energy resources. That means utility grid is being again operated with the same functionalities, right? And next we have the results for the superimposed directional current element. So here we have the results for the superimposed positive sequence directional element at R3 for different mode of system operations. So here we have the phasor diagrams at the faults for the fault point F1 during grid connected mode, for the fault point F2 during the grid connected mode, fault point F1 during islanded mode, fault parent F2 during islanded mode, right? So these things can be also studied by making use of the laboratory studies. So this is the schematic diagram of the hardware in loop. HIL is one of the software which is being used for the hardware realization studies. Even you can find it in search engine by typing HIL arrangement using the real-time digital simulator and DSpace for the implementation of the directional overcurrent relay technique, right? So this I have taken from IIT Roorkee. The author Premalata Jena and NP Padesa, they are authored this paper based on the protection of the smart grid protection They have the in IIT Roorkee, they have the real-time digital simulator, and they have the GTAO cards and GTA cards, and they are fixed. The real-time digital simulator and cards are on the backside, like GTAO and GTA. They are like say interfacing cards, right? With reference to the real-time three-phase currents and master IO ribbon cable execution of the directional over current relay technique on the board, and also distributed system model, which is being considered here, personal computer running the RSCAD and DSpace control center software. So based on this laboratory setup, they find some results in the hardware in loop. So these are the results, say the hardware results, which is being identified by at the IIT Roorkee. They have the hardware results for the trip signal at the different things for the creation of the fault at different time intervals, and the creation of the type of default at a different time intervals, like 2.5 amperes per division and like 120 milliseconds per division, like that. So here they have, say, tabulated these values, like real time three-phase current signals for the fault F2 during islanded mode for the conventional directional overcurrent relay, at relay 3, relay 6 for the adaptive protection at relay 3 and relay 6, right? Because we are doing the comparative study between the conventional approach and the adaptive approach, and this is a superimposed adaptive sequence, current based protection technique. So here in this, again we are going for the adaptive sequence, relay superimposed adaptive sequence current based protection system. So here in this case, we are going to make use of the the negative sequence and the positive sequence based superimposed components, the reverse and forward faults, and the sequence diagram of the for the free fault situation, and under this we have the superimposed adaptive sequence current based protection technique. We have the magnitude of the fault current is expressed and is being written on the basis of the inverter based distributed energy resources, that is delta IF can be expressed as by the mathematical equation. Similarly, in case of the synchronous based distributed energy resources, delta IF can be computed for the relays, and mathematically the fault current can be expressed as like this. And then we have the protections coordination, as we have discussed that protection coordination time interval. Coordination time interval is the main thing, which is the time interval between the main and backup relays. So here the IDMT characteristics refers to the time of operation and the TDS. So based on the microgrid mode of operation and the time dial setting of the adaptive superimposed sequence current relay, ASSCR is calculated as like this. The lower and upper limits of the relays are set as 0.05 and 1 respectively. The operation time limit for the both the primary relay and the backup relay within 1 second and desired CTI is coordination time interval is 0.3 seconds, which is being typical used in utility requirements with the relay settings. So these are the pre-fault negative sequence and positive sequence currents. These are the diagrams which are being used for the developed for the three bus system, which we have considered here for the symmetrical component representation. And similarly, the superimposed adaptive sequence current based protection technique. So in this, we have superimposed negative sequence current element. Negative sequence current element superimposed current is being calculated as delta I2F. Phasor diagram showing the superimposed negative sequence current for the fault at F1 side and fault at F2 side. And here you see the superimposed adaptive sequence current based protection system. The first section is same, but second section will vary. If you see for the adaptive superimposed sequence current relay, so here in this case we have computation of the impact factor, computation of delta I2F, delta I1F, and computation of the adaptive relay fault current, angle difference between the pre-fault current and fault current, calculate the time and apply the rule base. So then we have the simulation rules for the IEEE 30 bus 34 bus microgrid. This is the schematic diagram of the IEEE 34 bus microgrid, right? So for this, these are the results by making use of the inverter based distributed energy resources for the islanded mode of operation. And if you see in this slide, the time of coordination, time of interval is 0.378 corresponding to the fault point F2. And performance evaluation for negative sequence directional relaying technique, the superimposed negative sequence directional relaying technique, the where the selective property and the relays, the fault points F3 and F5, the negative sequence pre-fault and post-fault currents, the angle data, the results for the superimposed negative sequence current are represented as like this. So this is these are the different modes, mode M1, M2, M3, M4. M1 refers to inverter based, M2 refers to islanded based, M3 refers grid connected, and M4 refers mode of M4 refers the disconnection of the distributional energy resource. And these are the results for the superimposed positive sequence directional relaying technique. And the results for the superimposed positive sequence directional element at R5 for ABCG, that means say for the unsymmetrical fault, we have ABC ground type faults. For the ABC phase sequence, which we have considered here, AG for ground, that means we may use 1, 2, 3N or RYBN like that, type fault or microgrid operation. For this also, they have the hardware results at the IIT Roorkee. So these are the things, the hardware results are like this, right? These are the hardware test results for different time dial setting, adaptive sequence superimposed current relay, facing at different points, like we can have, say, for a traditional overcurrent primary relay at 6, traditional overcurrent backup relay 8, primary adaptive sequence superimposed sequence current relay 6, for backup relay also same like that. These are the hardware results. So this is the thing. So we can say that the three current and observed relay currents for the at fault 6 during the islanded mode of operation. So there are some different values are being observed. So this is how the protection scheme can be used for the microgrid protection system. Thank you all for your patience hearing. Hello, sir. Hello. Hello. Hello, sir. Hello. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Wonderful session, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Dear participants, any questions? Balaji, sir. Sanjay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a wonderful session, sir.
Thank you, madam.
Sojanya, okay, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Your valuable information.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Madam. Hello.
Hello, sir.
Sir.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for a wonderful session. Spending your valuable time with us. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Okay, sir.
Dear participants, anybody want to interact with me, sir?
Okay, sir. Any participating is posing any questions, sir? Shall I quit or anybody is in the line?
Yeah, I think nobody are raising any queries, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much on the behalf of my management and my department and my organizing committee of this 1 week FDP. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, sir.
For spending your valuable time and sparing your sharing your knowledge. Definitely, it enlightens the knowledge of our participants. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, sir.
For accepting.
Thank you very much, sir.
Delivering this session.
Thank you very much, sir, for your invitation. And this time sharing whatever the knowledge which I want to share with the audience.
Yeah. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Anandal. We will meet again in the afternoon at 2 p.m. I will share the quiz link in the our group, Telegram group. Thank you, Anandal.
Thank you.